Y'all hear me? I want you to be able to see something too. Adjourn on this topic next Monday, June 15th, at the Hardesty Library. They're having the second of five pro-river tax meetings, kind of a Hillary listening tour. So we listened, but we also launched a little surprise, which I like to do. So we met all the people arriving at the single entrance to the library. I'd like to recognize Ron, Larry, Fred, and Donna Toucher, who braved the boiling heat. They braved the boiling heat and the car exhaust. But we got a lot of positive feedback from visitors and attendees with honks and thumbs up. And we didn't get that other finger that I saw, except from maybe some people inside the library and the auditorium. They look like they've been chewing on persimmons. So I need, as part of Rhonda's leadership on this for Citizens for a Better Vision, we're going to attend all the rallies that they're having in the ProTax group, ask questions. They're allowing questions from the audience after they give their 1 hour canned PowerPoint presentation, and then they'll take questions. And we've asked some good questions. There was a few other folks that didn't attend the sign holding that did ask great questions from the group. I saw the Gallows there, I saw Bill Bickerstaff and a few others. So I encourage you next Monday to come to Hardesty, meet on the street sidewalk, 93rd. I'll have signs. If you have an idea, you can make it, please text me at my phone number, which is written on the sign-in sheet out there, or make note it's 810-8442. 810-8442. But it's on the sign-up roster out there if you think of it on the way out. And you can send me a text message. But I've got a half dozen signs, I'll make a few more, so that kind of gave me an idea if we're going to have a good turnout. And thank you very much. See you Monday.
Thank you, George. Thank you. Just a couple of things. Wanted to mention the Oklahoma GOP lunch with Senator Ted Cruz, fundraiser for the state party at the... I'm pretty sure it's the Oklahoma Sports Hall of Fame in Oklahoma City. It's on North Lincoln, just north of the state capitol. And anybody that can get free and go to Oklahoma City on Saturday is urged to support the state GOP in that regard. And then also, I know the county GOP is going to have a fundraising barbecue on June 28th. Go ahead and mention that. And our very own Congressman Jim Bridenstine turns 40, also on Saturday. Saturday's a busy day. And there's a birthday party event for Congressman Bridenstine. I'm sure you've all gotten the notifications and the invitations. And if you haven't... Yeah, it's from his campaign, and Peggy could fill Larry. Let's see, does anybody else have anything just quickly that they'd like to promote or say? Or I'm not going to invite open mic. If I said anybody have anything they want to get off their chest, I think there's a line would form over here, go out the door. That's why I'm restraining myself as well. I was kidding with Richard Engle. I said, yes, I had intended to buy Richard's book and at the county convention, and I had a chance. And I thought, no, I'm really bad about buying books, and then you got to hang, you know, haul it around all day, and end up under your chairs, and in the way. And so now I'm completely prepared for my task tonight because I now have a bio. Richard Engle is a past president of the National Federation of Republican Assemblies, which is the nation's largest and oldest Republican support organization. Richard was twice elected to the city council and twice elected to the Oklahoma delegation to the Republican National Convention, including serving on the National Rules Committee in 2000, where he successfully placed a minority report on the floor of the convention, the first and most recent since Ronald Reagan did the same in 1976. Richard is president of Bell West America. Richard and Denise, his wife of nearly 30 years, live in Oklahoma City. Denise Engle serves as Workers' Compensation Commissioner for the state of Oklahoma. Richard speaks and writes often on matters of public policy, including for us this evening. I look forward to reading the book, although I was going to say, I think the little blurb there on the sign, which is a little out of my range for my years of service, talks about the amid the deconstruction of the United States. So Richard is clearly an optimist, and we welcome him here tonight to talk to us. Richard.
So, can you hear me? Okay, can you hear me? Very good. I want to express my gratitude, my great appreciation for being welcomed back here to Tulsa. Tulsa is my hometown, by the way. I guess I've lived in the Oklahoma City area so long, most people don't know that I'm from here in Tulsa. Lived here as a youth and had formative years in the Tulsa area. Met my wife, Denise. She's actually originally born at St. Anthony in Oklahoma City, but grew up in Tulsa, was a graduate of Jenks as well as Victory Bible Institute. So, you know, we have a lot of Tulsa in us. And since the book has been released, this has been my first opportunity to speak in Tulsa, and I really appreciate that opportunity. I also want to specifically thank Rhonda. I know she's not here. She has, of course, welcomed me to come here and set this up. But she's been such a light of liberty, a great beacon of strength and reform and improvement for our state. She's been just a terrific warrior for what is right in our state and in our nation, and I greatly appreciate her. I greatly appreciate her support when I've run for party office. I think many of you supported me in that. Tulsa County supported me like 3 or 4 to 1. So. This is very much home turf for me, even though I've been living in the city area for so long. And I really wanted to express my appreciation. I also want to express specific appreciation for my college roommate, William Wright, who's standing at the back and helping me with the books. You've mentioned, and some others have mentioned to me, that they intended to purchase my book at the Tulsa County Convention. They saw the booth there. They went into the convention. And when the convention was over, they came out, and there was no booth. I was at the Oklahoma County Convention running a booth, and I had my brother running my booth in Tulsa County, and somehow he thought when people left for lunch, when there really wasn't a lunch, that it was over. And so I ditched him and brought Bill. So, anyway. And I greatly appreciate the introduction that you gave me, the kind introduction, which I wrote myself, as you can tell, because I wrote it in the book. But it's important to understand that I am speaking to you from that background of so many years of experience in the political realm, and it's been mostly behind the curtain areas. Yes, I've been in public office a couple of times, but most of my efforts, most of my work has been as an activist and has been in that behind the scenes area, as many of you have done. And I wrote this book from that perspective. You know, I don't know how often you get a novelist here at Tulsa 912. Usually you're talking about specific issues of import to our nation, to our state. And here I'm bringing you a novel, and you've got to be thinking, what on earth could he be doing? And it has been a wonderful trip. It's been a wonderful thing. This novel, The Last American President, it's obviously political fiction. And why would I write fiction when I've been involved myself in politics? Well, there are things that I know that for confidentiality reasons I just am not permitted to say and attach a name to, and so you write it in fiction to be able to kind of separate a little bit. I also found out that fiction is a great means to separate people from their daily grind and get them to look with a different perspective at where they're at and how things are. I certainly appreciated the work of Harriet Beecher Stowe with Uncle Tom's Cabin, with Upton Sinclair, with The Jungle, with Ayn Rand, with her many books, including Atlas Shrugged. And my favorite, frankly, is C.S. Lewis with That Hideous Strength. Now, I think many of you are probably familiar with C.S. Lewis's books. You didn't probably know that he wrote political fiction, but That Hideous Strength certainly qualifies as political fiction. And I realized that you can do that. You can affect people's thinking about major issues and ideas with the medium of fiction. And that was the intention of this story. And it has been going well. It's been selling very well. And in fact, I was told that after the first month, we had sold more copies than the average author does in a lifetime. And it's gone up since then. And that's just, I'm just very honored and very impressed. Didn't say it for that reason. But it's a wonderful experience to have people purchase your book, to come up to you and ask, and obviously to read it and to appreciate it and to talk to others about it, and it's gotten some very, very good reviews. In fact, the Tulsa Beacon called it a must-read recently, which is wonderful. I love that kind of review because it's very short. You can use really short reviews like that in your promotions. But, you know, and people come up to you and they ask you to sign it, and, you know, you feel, oh, geez, you know, sure, and that's great, and it's a humbling and an honor, and they, you know, so you sign it and you give it to them. It's a great thing. Well, I'll tell you, just about a month and a half after the book was released, I was in the parking lot. I pulled up into the parking lot of the IHOP in Belle Isle, which, if you're familiar with Oklahoma City, the Belle Isle IHOP is right off Interstate 44. Pulled up and started walking towards the building, you know, got out of my car and started walking towards the building. And this young, 20-ish young lady is coming towards me out of the building, and she sees me and she's, OMG, I can't believe it's you. And I'm like, okay. And she says, can I have your autograph? And I'm not holding a book, and she's not holding a book, and it's just an IHOP. And I'm thinking, wow, the online sales must be a whole lot better than I've been told so far. It's like, sure. And, you know, my wife said, always have your autograph pen with you regardless, and I did. And I said, sure, but do you have something to write on? And she had one of these, I don't know, these monstrous purses that some young ladies carry. She starts fishing around in this huge purse and pulls out a piece of cardboard. Now, why she had a piece of cardboard in her purse? Just plain, simple, square cardboard, like the back end of a pad without any of the pad. And she hands it to me. Okay. I asked her name. I think it was Tammy. To Tammy and best wishes, and I signed it. And if anybody's seen my signature, you know you just really can't read it. It's an autograph. It's not good penmanship signature. And she takes it. Oh, thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you. And she looks at it. And she looks at it. And she looks at it. Finally, she turns it to me and she says, how does this say Billy Bob Thornton? I said stage name and just walked out. I don't know how, after talking to me even those few words, she thought I was Billy. I may have some physical resemblance, but certainly not a vocal one. Anyway, but And then some people say, okay, well, your name is Richard Engle, and there's that NBC reporter named Richard Engle, and maybe you'll get some extra sales out of it because of that. Like, you know, that could work, unless he goes all Brian Williams on me. And then that could work to my disadvantage, so we'll see. So people have asked, okay, well, who is the last American president? And, of course, some people come up to me and they see this and they say, well, that must be a book about George W. Bush, because they're pretty sure that the president we have now isn't American. But it's really supposed to be the final American president. And that's not a really pleasant premise to write a book about the very last, that there would be a final American president. But that is the storyline, and it is a cautionary tale. People say, why would you write the last American president? Well, when I was in school, my teachers told me to write what you know. And when I started this a little over about 5.5 years ago, all the books and movies, obviously, were about vampires. And I've never met a vampire. Now, politics and politicians, I know. But wait a minute. Bloodsuckers, politicians. Maybe there's a correlation there. I'm not sure. This thing keeps shrinking on me. So I have to pull it up so I can read. Then it can fall down again. But, you know, there is a... But I wrote about what I knew. I wrote about politics and politicians and the process that we're familiar with and the situation that we're in. And I wrote it as a cautionary tale. People say that the difference between truth and fiction is that fiction has to make sense. You know, truth can be stranger than fiction, right? And so I wrote it from that perspective. I tried to write a story that would make sense, that would communicate well with you, that would be a process through that, okay, that could happen, okay, that could happen. And the reality of life is the things that can't happen do. But I had to write a story that could in order for people to appreciate the storyline. And then, of course, people talk about judging a book by the cover. And, you know, I heard one novelist say, how, you know, he was in a radio interview, and he was asked, when did you figure out that your book was going to be a bestseller? You had a bestseller on your hands. And he said, when they put a picture of a naked lady on the cover. Well, we didn't put a picture of the naked lady on the cover, and we wouldn't do that, and that's not the story. I wanted a cover that communicated the story inside the book so that you can judge the book by the cover. And so there's many symbols and images on the cover that really do communicate well the story. If any of you here have already read the story, then I hope you will attest that I think we've accomplished that well, that we have created a cover that really does communicate the essence of the idea of the story in there. And then people ask about the character. Where did you get these characters? Well, I will tell you that they're life stories. They're compilations of people that I know and images and impressions that I have of my experiences around this country and to some degree around the world of people that I know. But as any honest author of fiction would tell you, to write a novel, you have to somewhat be a successful schizophrenic. You know, all the characters really do have to be in your head. And so I try to communicate characters that are based on compilations of people that I know. There's no single person that is any single character. There is no single person that is indeed the man who I portray as the very last American president. He is not me. There is a character that when you read it, you'll say, okay, I think that one's Richard, and you might well be right if you know me well. And I knew that having spoken with so many authors, I knew that there's always a character that is the author, so I did it on purpose. Got that out of the way and took care of that. But, decades of experience inside politics, as I mentioned, behind the curtain of politics are the background of this story. And the last American president is indeed very much a human drama. I'm going to put these down if you don't mind. You will see that it's very much a character-driven story. It's what may happen to the United States of America. But it's also the life story of the man who becomes the very last American president. You'll laugh, you'll cry, there's humor, there's romance, there's betrayal, there's personal tragedy, there's political intrigue, all set against the backdrop of the dissolution of the United States of America. Which does give rise to the question, will there indeed be a last American president? will the United States of America cease to exist? I once heard that Woody Allen was giving a commencement address to a college. Not exactly a hero of mine, but he said something fun. He looked at his crowd full of skulls full of mush, as Rush Limbaugh would say, and he said, "You have a choice to make. On the one hand, utter desolation. On the other, total annihilation. Choose wisely." Not exactly a positive message, obviously. It's like, how do you choose between two things that are terrible? And among other things that I do that aren't in the front flap of that book is I teach social studies, history, largely, at a Christian academy in Edmond Christian Academy. And I do that part-time. And in my history teaching and in the studies that I've done regarding history on my own, because I love the subject, you know, all indications in America are for collapse. Every empire in the world has fallen from within before it fell from without. And you can look at the Greek, the Roman, the Mongol, the Byzantine, the British, the Soviet. Every one of them fell first from within before it fell from without. It was outside forces merely taking advantage of the crumbling that was already happening. Are we seeing any of that? Of foreign powers taking advantage of the crumbling that's happening in our own government? Every one of them falls for financial and moral reasons. And one could easily say that financial causes are moral causes for that collapse. So, you know, America's really no exception. We are in a bad state. As I was introduced, you know, I don't sound like all that much of an optimist, do I? But let's think about it. Right now, we've exceeded $18 trillion in debt. Now, what does that mean? It seems like a lot. We all acknowledge, you know, it's more than doubled in this one administration alone. That makes it sound big and bad. It doubled prior in just a few administrations. So it's obvious that we're accelerating ourselves in debt. But, you know, I watched a video of a speech by Ronald Reagan in 1964 called A Time for Choosing, in which he's speaking on behalf of Barry Goldwater for president. It's a great speech. It's one of the three most important political speeches in American history. You should get it. You can simply get it online. You can go to National Federation of Republican Assemblies, you know, the NFRA website, and it plays there. You can get it a lot of places free. Listen to it. Watch it. It's a great speech. But in that speech, he was talking about the problem of the national debt. That was 1964. I was alive in 1964. I was certainly not competent to watch political speeches in 19. I was a very, very young child, and now I'm very gray-haired. We've lived our entire lives with a large, imposing debt hanging over our head, and it's easy to think, well, we've made it this far, we're going to make it further, it's going to be okay, or if it's not going to be okay, we'll figure it out. And we don't realize that large debt that Ronald Reagan was talking about was a tiny portion of what it is today. And then I've heard economists say, well, our debt's not really all that bad. It's just now approaching the percentage to GDP that it was towards the end of World War II. Near the end of World War II, the debt to GDP ratio was 125%. Basically, if everything we produced domestically, not a bit of it went to food or clothing or energy or the energy paying for the machines that were producing things, everything went into the debt for a year and 3 months, that would have paid off the debt. And we're just now approaching that same 125% of debt to gross domestic product, so it can't be that bad. Well, let's think about that just a little bit. Towards the end of World War II, there were millions of Americans not gross domestically producing. They were off fighting the Nazis and the Japanese, and they knew that they were about to come home, and the country ramped up the debt and ramped up the effort to get it over with, get them home, and create the biggest post-war boom in human history so that we could pay that down. And an extraordinarily small amount of our debt right now comes from then. We actually never did pay it all off, and we started escalating it again. realize also that when they came home, nearly every woman who was working stopped. And many women weren't working then. And what are we today? We're all out there gross domestically producing as fast as we can. We're all like the hamsters on the wheel, just running as fast as we can, trying to maintain a standard of living that seems to be falling under us, as really, frankly, a lot of our efforts are going into what is happening in our government. It's not just taxes. It's the effective tax of inflation, the effective tax of the big debt, the effective tax of the regulations that our government's putting on us. $18 trillion. Yeah, and then we have obviously lots of local taxes and debts. And we're like, what is $18 trillion? Well, let's think about the most valuable commodity we probably know of, that's gold. Gold is around $1,200 an ounce, 16 ounces to the pound, 2,000 pounds to the ton. Fort Knox, we're told, has about 8,083 tons of gold. Maybe, but let's say it does. We could sell that off and pay off the debt, right? Well, let's say we were to sell that off and not flood the market and create a change in the price whatsoever. If we could do that, and if it was all there, we would get less than $400 billion. Less than half of one of the $18 trillion of our debt. That's pretty terrible. That's pretty extreme. In fact, Fort Knox has 4.62% of the world's gold. All the gold in the world. The ring on your finger. The necklace on your neck. Every piece of gold that has ever been mined and refined by man. 4.62% of it is in Fort Knox. Well, that means that there's only 22 Fort Knoxes in the world. And it would take 45 of them to pay off our debt. There's not enough gold in the world to pay off half of the national debt of the United States. Okay, that brings it home a little bit. Now let me make it better. Well, worse. There's something called unfunded liabilities. Something we didn't have when we were at 125% of gross domestic product to debt at the end of World War II, or debt to gross domestic product, the other way around. Unfunded liabilities. What's that? That's Social Security. That's Medicaid, Medicare. That's veterans' benefits. They deserve what they signed up for. That's retirement benefits of all federal employees and other things. Those are the non-discretionary spending that congressmen talk about, the things they have to pay that doesn't show up as debt. And experts say that our unfunded liabilities range between $128 and $203 trillion. That makes that $18 trillion sound really small. But you know what really bothers me about that? Is that experts can't get the range any closer than between $128 and $203 trillion. They honestly have no idea how much we owe the people who are expecting us to pay them. And oh, by the way, that's us. And so a huge percentage of the taxes that we pay are going into paying these unfunded liabilities. We could pay off our debt if we could reduce the budget, today's amount of spending, by $1 trillion and keep it at that exact level while continuing to pay the taxes we're paying right now for 40 years. Now, why 40 and not 18? Because we're spending more than. And even during that 40 years, we have to pay interest on. So it would take 40 years of reducing our expenditures by $1 trillion while maintaining our taxes as they are right now for 40 years. The big problem with that is that gets rid of all of the discretionary spending and eats into the unfunded liabilities, the non-discretionary spending. It's just not going to happen. That's just to pay off the debt. How do you pay off the unfunded liabilities? Let's talk about the debt one other thing. At that time, at the end of World War II, towards the end of World War II, if I asked a room like this, how many of you have a savings bond, a war bond, every adult hand would go up. Let me ask you now, how many of you have a savings bond? And I see one hand, two hands. So who's holding that debt?
largely it's being held by other countries. This is how they can have their cake and eat it too. Let's talk about China, Japan, Germany, lots of countries hold our national debt because we're not holding it ourselves anymore. Back then, we owed it to us. We trusted us that we would pay us and it would be okay, and now they hold it. Well, let's say China. You know, everybody's complaining about Hillary Clinton being influenced by foreign money, taking foreign money for her foundation and being influenced by it. Well, sorry guys, we're already influenced by foreign money. We've already taken foreign money and we'll do what they want or else. Because what if we don't do what China wants? China will say, well, that's fine. Pay the debt now. Well, we can inflate our currency and do it, and then all hell breaks loose. Or we could pay it, and then we'd have to borrow the money from somebody else fast. If you have to borrow money fast, what do you end up doing? You end up paying a much higher interest rate. So we would have this huge interest rate, which inflates the currency, and the same stuff breaks loose. So they know that they can pull our strings. They can do it. Japan can do it. Germany can do it. A lot of countries can do that. They can pull our strings and say, change this policy or we're dumping your debt. You know, that's a lot of what people are saying, various countries are saying to Greece right now. Pay us or change your policies to what we want. And the people of Greece are saying, no, don't change the policies to what they want. We're supposed to be in charge of our government. Now, they want to be in charge of their government to continue doing wasteful things. And guess what? So do we. Americans, by and large, want the government to continue doing wasteful things. We're not really better than Greece. We just want to feel like we're better off than Greece. And so they get to pull our strings and get us to change our policies the way they want, like, for instance, Obama trade. And if we don't, they dump. And if we do, they hold it and continue making interest and continue to have that threat of being able to dump it. And if they need just a little bit, they can dump just a little bit of it and still pull our strings and still get the interest. I mean, it's having your cake and eating it too. It's a problem. It's a really, really big problem. And as I mentioned, every empire has fallen for these reasons. You know, in my studies of history, there is indeed one way to prevent your empire from falling. There's only one. Would you like to know what it is? Don't have one. That's it. That's the only way. The only way to keep it from crumbling is don't have an empire. And our founding fathers didn't create our Constitution and our government to be an empire. But guess what? Everybody else in the world thinks it's one, even if you don't. We've got over 900 military bases around the world. You know how many military bases China has not in China? Zero. Russia has a couple, but they think it's Russia. They're wrong, but they got a couple bases in places they think are Russia. Britain has a few in places that are not Britain, nor are their territories. We have more than anybody else. They think we're an empire, whether we think so or not. Now, should we have our military? Should we have a strong military? I'm a Reagan guy. I'm for strong military. I'm very for strong military. But there's a point at which it becomes really a problem. You know, my brother-in-law is in the military, and he had to spend a tour in South Korea at a base in Seoul, because Seoul is right up by the DMZ. And we had to pay, had to pay his rent on an apartment at $5,000 a month. Now, at the end of the Korean War, Seoul was not an expensive city in which to live. A lot of what has caused it to be an expensive city to live is our military presence there, which may be good, but it is also causing a huge economic impact on their country. You know, we talk about BRAC and we talk about closing down military bases here, and we know what an economic impact that would have if we closed down military bases in Oklahoma. Well, we have the same kind of impact if we close down military bases in other countries. But we're having that impact on their country. You know. Anyway, it is a problem. Our debt's a problem. Our unfunded liabilities are a problem. The expansiveness of our nation is a problem. Our inability to, okay, Teddy Roosevelt said it very well, walk softly and carry a big stick. And I think we've done pretty good with the big stick. It's the other side of it. You know, you got to have the strong military, but you got to back up your words, but you got to be able to use words. And again, my favorite president in my lifetime, Ronald Reagan, did a pretty darn good job of that. He built up our military and didn't use it all the time. He used it very sparingly, very carefully, protected the lives of our young men, protected the funds of our country. That's kind of the example we should have been going with all along. You know, America is a unique country, but we have a serious problem. We want to fix this. Feels like, you know, okay, do you have an answer? You know, you gotta have an answer. Well, folks, I'm sorry. I didn't come here to write another novel. You know, my novel has a happy ending. You'll like it. I'm sorry, the reality may not be quite so happy. Are we beyond the point of no return? I think that the United States of America, our government, may well be beyond the point of no return. The question isn't will it collapse, it's when it collapses, and how far we can kick it down the road. And maybe we can live through it. Maybe our kids can live through it. Not so sure our grandkids might. Pretty darn certain our great-grandkids won't. And then what happens? You know, I don't relish the idea of an international border running down the Mississippi River or 50 international borders around our country. I relish the idea of being able to trade and travel from sea to shining sea without anyone stopping me. I love America, and I love that we have that freedom to travel and to trade and to do what we want to do in that broad sense. But what's the answer? I don't have an answer. Well, I do. But I have to ask you a question. Do you want to save your country or your government? You know, you already answered it, didn't you? America is a unique country. It's not like others. I mean, there's a couple similar in this perspective. But for the most part, we don't have a unifying ethnic identity in the United States of America. You know, having gone to Bible school, I studied Greek. The Greek word for nation is ethnos, from which we get the term ethnic. We don't have a unifying ethnic identity. But we have a unifying ethic. We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal, and they're endowed by their Creator with certain inalienable rights, among them life, liberty, pursuit of happiness. That really is foundational to the American ethic. And sometimes we confuse our government with our nationality. We overly identify the government of the United States of America with our identity as being Americans. And if there wasn't that government, we think that we wouldn't be Americans anymore. And it's disturbing. And the problem with that excessive ID is it makes us want to support that foolish government more, to prop it up more. It puts a restraint on us from being too critical of it, because being too critical of it makes us critical of who we are, because we became self-realized as Americans at about the same time we got a government for America. It was that Declaration of Independence that really put in such beautiful terms the thing that was already alive in the hearts of Americans throughout the colonies that became our ethic. And from that ethic came other things, like the American work ethic, the American dream. That all comes from that same thing. There will always be an America. We're not going to suddenly be some other country, regardless of what happens to our government. You know, French people are not French because of government in Paris. There were never such a thing as East Germans or West Germans. They were just Germans with a line down and two separate governments. There's no such thing as South Koreans and North Koreans. There are Koreans, some of which have a bad government, and some have a really, really, really bad government. But they are just Koreans. And we need to kind of look in the mirror and realize we are Americans, not because of our government, but because of who we are, because of the similarities we hold. One of my favorite authors, Peter Jennings, said that Americans are more dissimilar than they are more similar than they are dissimilar. We have more in common than we have not in common. Yeah, we joke sometimes about how people from Boston can't pronounce the letter R. We joke sometimes that the foods people eat in different places and the habits. Like, for instance, you can't walk down a street in Seattle without tripping over a coffee shop. Between two coffee shops on the corners is a coffee shop in the middle. You know, but those are little bitty things that don't really identify us very differently. We have a lot in common as Americans. You know, I think about the founding fathers, and I think about their patriotism. And when we think of patriotism, we ordinarily think of the holiday we're going to be celebrating in less than a month. We think of the flag that we salute. We think of the Capitol building, the Washington Monument, the White House. We think of the Statue of Liberty. We may, in our mind's eye, have that picture of the patchwork that is the 50 different states, sea to shining sea of our continent. We may even be thinking of, because this is Tulsa 9/12, the Constitution itself. But when Sam Adams, George Washington, and John Hancock, and Patrick Henry, when they were called patriots, none of those things existed. They were patriots to the ideals. And we have so often become confused and become patriots to the symbol rather than to the ideal. And so I do kind of want to challenge you to become patriots again, like Sam Adams, like George Washington, like Patrick Henry, to the ideals, and know what it means to be patriotic. I do hope that you will buy and read The Last American President. Because, you know, I'm in that business. But more importantly, I hope you'll gain a new understanding of what it means to be an American. It's much deeper than our government. It's much better than our government ever was. I hope you'll gain a new understanding of what it means to be a patriot. I hope that you will take this and increase in your activism. I'm speaking to a group of activists. Grow with that. You know, the protagonist in this story, the man who becomes the very last American president, he's a good guy. He's a Republican. He's a conservative. He gets rid of entire departments of the federal government. I don't want to give away too much of the story. You know, he does everything he can to preserve the Union. But unfortunately, he gets there just a little bit too late. It's that Wile E. Coyote moment, you know, the Saturday morning cartoons we watch, where he's racing down the desert and doesn't realize that he's gone past the cliff edge, and there's a chasm below, and he pauses just for a moment, midair, kind of feels under his feet. There's no ground. Pulls out a sign. You know? You never know if you're past the point of no return until you're past the point of no return. So what do we do? Do we just throw up our hands and say it's too late, we can't save it? The protagonist in this story doesn't. He does everything he can. He does everything he can to save it, to preserve it, to protect it. And it doesn't work. But he softens the blow. The good actions you take will have a good result. They may not have the result you intended. I intended to win, National Committee man. I won by two, but... but the good of your activity is still good and will have a good result, first off, in you, and second off, on others anyway. So don't ever, we didn't win this one. No, I won by doing what was right and moral and true, regardless of the outcome. You won by doing what is right and moral and true and good and standing up for what you believe in because it's right to do so. And even if it doesn't work out the way you want it to, the way you expect it to, the way you think it should, the way you're right, it actually should, you'll soften the blow. You will be salt. You will be light. And that is the positive side of the story. Thank you very much. I hope you have questions. Done hundreds of radio interviews. But one of them I did was on the east coast of Virginia. They have a specific eastern shore, whatever, that area. And they said, Eric Cantor spent millions of dollars to win re-election. And we raised and spent, this was a Tea Party type radio show, we raised and spent $200,000 and we beat him. And the guy that won is doing the same things Eric Cantor did. What do we do? And I said, raise $20,000 and beat him. You have to say no, and you have to say no again, and you have to say no again. You have to keep standing up and keep standing firm and keep pushing strong, persuade, which is a lot of why I wrote this book, because stories persuade. Listening to Ronald Reagan, he didn't just give statistics. He gave stories, human stories. And if you can humanize your point, you'll have a much greater effect of persuading people. Other questions? Yes, sir.
Have you been able to speak at any colleges or universities?
Not yet, and I would love to. Please pass it on. I am available. I have long suggested, based on the writings of Thomas Jefferson, the Declaration of Independence, that the purpose of government, the proper role of government, is limited to securing our rights to life, liberty, and property. And doing anything more than that is tyranny. And we'll tell our governing officials their job is to secure our rights to life, liberty, and property. And then they're not listening, but they're also deliberately misunderstanding. Because they're saying, well, that little boy playing alone, his life might be endangered by playing alone in his own yard. Those kids that went to the park 6 blocks away may be in danger because they're walking 6 blocks from their home. The people who would be customers of the little girl lemonade stand might get poisoned, I remember when I was in first grade, there was a boy who apparently failed first grade prior. He was the biggest kid in my class. His name was Otto. And Otto was not a real nice boy. And he was put next to me because we were in alphabetical order in the class. And every day, he would tell me to give him a crayon. And every day, I'd give him a crayon, and he'd return it to me broken. I've got to figure out a way to stop him from breaking my crayons. My parents bought me a box of 64 crayons, and there's more than 64 days in the year. I'm going to run out altogether. And so I thought, one day, well, I'll just give him back the broken crayon he gave me back yesterday. Well, he wouldn't take it. He refused.
So I got this bright idea as a first grader, and I went through and broke every one of my 64 crayons to prevent him from breaking my crayons. And you know that made sense if you're a first grader. And our government protects our safety and our freedom by preventing us from having safety and freedom. It's counterproductive. And we're adult enough to know that we laugh about a kid who breaks his own crayons to prevent Otto from breaking his crayons. We also should be adult enough to know that the government is not protecting our security when it ruins our security. And I think the scenario regarding the NSA is a great example of that. That's Otto breaking our crayons. It's us saying we will be unsafe and unsecure in our papers and property and possessions and privacy to prevent being unsafe in our people, our persons and our property and our papers and our... I haven't voted for anybody I hadn't at least met as well as studied since 1984. And check my voting records, I vote every time. That's at any level, not just president, not just city council, not just every level. There is no substitute for activism. And I learned this little lesson when I moved up to Iowa for 3 years to pastor a church. I moved up right after the Iowa caucuses and was only there 3 years and moved away before the next ones. But this lady in my church, she played the piano. Her name was Bonnie Grabenbauer. I will go fast. Bonnie Grabenbauer, okay, I thought you were trying to, okay. Bonnie Grabenbauer decided while I was there to run for city council in Marshalltown, Iowa. And Bonnie had lived in her home her entire life. She'd inherited it from her parents. She had a beauty salon at the end of her street at the busy corner. Okay? And both of those were in her ward of Marshalltown, Iowa. And she made up and then mimeographed, this was a long time ago, these flyers, 8.5 by 11 sheets of paper, she called them flyers. And she was going to go campaigning with her flyers. And she went next door to her next door neighbor who was a client of hers at her beauty salon, knocked on the door and said, I've decided to run for city council and I want your vote, and gave her a flyer. And her neighbor said, that's great. Remember, this is Iowa. That's great. Come on in. We'll talk about it. And Bonnie said, you've known me for years. You're a client in my beauty salon. And she said, if Bob Dole can sit at my kitchen table, so can you. There is no substitute for insistent, activized voters. There is no substitute for activism. There's no amount of money that can pay for what you do with Tulsa 912 and other organizations. Oklahoma has given the rest of the country a lot of reason to be depressed. And it's not because we've elected in the first district a tremendously fine man for Congress. It's because in Oklahoma, the reddest of the red, the buckle of the Bible Belt, the heart of conservatism, we only have one Jim Bridenstine in the state. Corporations are largely at this point built on what John the Baptist said of Jesus. I must decrease and he must increase. And I'm not speaking of Jesus in this perspective when it comes to politics. I'm speaking actually of my wife, who has been deputy insurance commissioner and then work comp commissioner, and just recently, on purpose, left the work comp commission, went into the private sector because it's illegal for a state employee to run for office. So you can expect to see her running for insurance commissioner in the state of Oklahoma, and you will see, based on her bio, that she will certainly be the most qualified and most well-experienced and most able insurance commissioner candidate in the history of the state of Oklahoma, and so I intend to help her and support her. Yes, sir. A lot of people have asked me about, you know, I don't want to support the Republican Party. It's not about supporting the Republican Party. It's about being often the loyal opposition within it. Yeah, a lot of times we need to be the loyal opposition within the party. Now, maybe within the state party, we don't need to be the loyal, we are the majority, but as a state party, we need to be the loyal opposition within the whole party. I do not give a penny to the RNC. Amen. I don't trust them to support the candidates for Congress also I would support. I find out enough information to support them myself.
Amen.
And so how long can we use this tool? Jim Garlock, who was one of the professors at my college, and he actually taught homiletics. And he talked about political parties one time, and he said they're like sailboats. You know, sailboats have to tack in the wind. They go one direction, then they go the other direction, then they go the other direction in order to get to a place. And so long as the effective direction that sailboat is going the right way for you, fine. And at a point when there's another one going the right way better, switch. And I don't think there's any close to going the right way better than the Republican Party is as a means of conveyance from one place to another. Some may like the Libertarian Party because it's sailing straight into the headwinds and not getting very far very fast. But as soon as it is going better, faster, and the right way better, then maybe it's time to switch. But until then, it's not. If the Constitution is the supreme law of the land, a person who violates the Constitution ought to be a supreme law breaker. And I don't know why we think that it's bad to break some recently made, man-made, goofy law that probably contradicts some other recently man-made, goofy law, and it's okay to break the law of the land, which is the Constitution of the United States. I don't get that. But I'll tell you also, in addition to voting for the best one, we need to make relationships with them early.
Amen.
And keep those relationships going. You know, you can have a lot more impact than just as a voter. You are active, and Jim Bridenstine probably knows half the names in this room himself already. Unfortunately, a room like this in the 4th Congressional District, Tom Cole wouldn't know all those names. Create relationships, and you can hold their feet to the fire. Many of them change, and it's that one step at a time, it's that one compromise at a time, it's that one little thing that they could justify to another thing that they have to rationalize, to another thing they have to be ashamed of, and it's a process. And, you know, I kind of did that again with the cover of my book. I mentioned he's a good man, a very good man. He's a man you would be proud to have as president. He's a man who gets rid of entire departments of the federal government. He's a shadow walking out of an empty room. But a shadow is what? A pawn, if you haven't seen the cover. And unbeknownst to him, even to that good man, ends up getting used by others. It ends up being manipulated. That's a reality of politics that, frankly, I think term limits has a lot of positive effect on preventing. And you have to be discerning. Discernment is huge, because there can be something you would do that would be perfectly fine to do, and you need to be discerning as to what the impact of that will be, or the effect of that will be later, that wouldn't be so fine. And so far, Jim Bridenstine's been discerning, and I'm really appreciative. Yeah, I think there's somebody over here. Okay. Yes, now. How many of you ever watched the John Stossel show? Okay. And when he has a guest that gets too wonkish, he, you know, squeezes the horn. Does anybody have one of those horns? Because I'm about to get really, really wonkish. I've been to Republican National Committee meetings more than some members of the Republican National Committee. Okay. Even to this day. The realities are, okay, when it comes to New Hampshire, they have that somewhat open primary, which is really problematic. The bigger problem is that over the years, you know, he mentioned the minority report I put on the floor of the convention. That minority report was to prevent a rule change that the majority report had to make the National Committee members superdelegates to the convention. And Morton Blackwell, the National Committee man from Virginia, great friend of mine, he helped me do that. And I'm telling you, that's no small task to get a minority report on the floor, to have Newt Gingrich read your minority report at the convention. That's no small task. It was hard to get that done. They put a lot of blockades in the rules to do that because they don't want dissension on the floor of a convention. But since then, And since, frankly, Minority Report did not pass, and they succeeded in getting the Majority Report, which included the superdelegates. So the first time in the history of the Republican Party, we had superdelegates. Now, about a quarter of the Democrat convention is superdelegates. It's not that high in the Republican Party, but that's when you can point to a date in history when the Republican Party deliberately started going less grassroots. Now, something happened in Tampa, and it was insane. Okay, the Republican National Committee meets, and I was the member from Oklahoma, even though I wasn't a Republican National Committee man. I was the member from Oklahoma, representing Oklahoma, on the Republican National Committee because James Dunn gave me his proxy, and they all know me. And I walked in and I worked with them, and the Republican National Committee was steadfast against two rules change proposals. And what always happens is the RNC presents a working draft of rules for the party to the rules committee that's made up of two delegates from each state. One man and one woman from each state delegation makes up the rules committee. The rules committee doesn't just set rules for the convention, they set rules for the party going forward for 4 years. The RNC always gives them a draft, so they work from the draft proposal of the RNC. So when they walk in, they don't see the existing rules, they see this draft rules, and they amend or accept based on that. There were two proposed rules that came out of the District of Columbia, which has as many Republicans as would fit in that sound booth. And both of them were the National Committee members from the District of Columbia, and both of them were the Rules Committee members from the District of Columbia, because the District of Columbia doesn't have many Republicans. Not that are actually living there and voting there. There's lots of Republicans who live there but have homes back home. And you know, you get this marvelous line in Virginia that's all the Republicans live there, and this line that's part of Virginia and Maryland, all the Democrats live there in the suburbs. But the two rules proposals were, I will title them rather than give the numbers, delegate discipline rule, and then the rules flexibility rule. Now, the delegate discipline rule says, in effect, that a delegate to the Republican National Convention has to do what they're told or they'll be removed, okay? And Mitt Romney being the nominee and him having his religious background, the scuttlebutt was basically wanted to turn the Republican National Convention into a Mormon Tabernacle Choir type, you know, everybody dress the same, look the same, do the same. And but regardless of that image, it's really the truth. They wanted to turn it into that. Do as you're told or you'll be removed. You're not a delegate. I mean, it's severe. That's the smaller and less problematic rule. The bigger and more problematic rule is rules flexibility, saying that the rules of the Republican Party can be changed between conventions. Not only can they be changed between conventions, they can be changed at any time between conventions, which means they can be changed right before the convention. They can be changed during the nominating process. They can be changed to say, the right guy won Iowa, let's come up with a really good argument for Iowa getting more delegates. The wrong guy wins New Hampshire, let's come up with a really good argument to remove some of the delegates that New Hampshire would get. Now, the reality is, and it always has been, that the Republican National Committee, by and large, its majority, is very much beholden to the previous nominee of the Republican Party. It just is. Okay? And you're not going to change that. No matter how grassroots the party gets, there will be a significant degree of loyalty to whoever the previous nominee was. If the previous nominee won president, believe me, that loyalty goes through the roof. If he didn't become president, they still are loyal to him. So for all intents and purposes, Mitt Romney owns a majority of the Republican National Committee. And he could have gotten the nomination. And he toyed with it. And people say, oh, not Mitt Romney again. He won't win. Well, he could win the nomination. Because if he says he wants it, they kind of can hand it to him. And so he toyed with it, and then he backed off. You're going to see a very similar story in here. I wrote this over an 18-month period 5.5 years ago, and then edit and edit and edit since then. So the story has all of that in there. So he can control it. Now, the good news of that is it's not going to be Jeb Bush. Why? Because it's not in the interest of a Mitt Romney to hand the presidency or the nomination, the party structure, back over to the Bush family. So that's the good. I mean, Mitt Romney's not that bad of a guy. You know, I don't want a tyrant who's good or a tyrant who's bad. But nonetheless, I mean, you know, it's not going to be Jeb. But he can, even without trying. It's not like the boss walks up to you and says, jump, and you say, how high? That's not how it works at that level. This is how it works at that level. A friend of the boss says, the boss thinks jumping might be nice. And everybody not only jumps as high as they can, they jump as fast as they can, as often as they can, and they persuade everybody they can to jump as high as they can, as fast as they can, as often as they can. They spend their money on jumpers, okay? That's how it works. So if somebody who seems to be in the Romney camp suggests that Romney would really like it to be Scott Walker, it's going to be Scott Walker. And it doesn't matter what the grassroots say. Sorry. Yeah, I mean, they do want to win, but they also, who are they? They have positions themselves, and they want to win their own position. What's more important to you, you know, your business or the great new business the Chamber of Commerce wants to bring in? The most important thing is retaining your own position, and if the money that you'll need to win your own position is in the Romney camp, you'll go for Romney. If the money you need is in the Bush camp, you'll go for Bush. You're going to go where that money is. And that's why the RNC is majority of it, not all of it. I certainly don't think Carolyn McLarty or Steve Fair are there, are effectively, even if subconsciously, owned by Mitt Romney right now, because that's where they got the favors that they needed. Yes, and the money guy is the guy who's been nominated. Reagan was the exception. And, you know, the Republican Party has a history of nominating the heir apparent, and that sounds worse than it is because Reagan was the heir apparent in 1980, and that was a good thing. Sometimes it's good. Anyway. And I can appreciate that, but realize, you know, presidents are elected by states, and so numbers of Republicans don't really matter. It wouldn't really matter in Oklahoma how many Republicans don't vote for the Republican nominee for president. The Oklahoma's going to go Republican. It matters in Missouri. It matters in Colorado. It matters in those battleground states. There are states that every single Republican cannot vote because it doesn't matter. They're going to go Democrat anyway. And in Oklahoma, it's going to go Republican anyway. The only margin is in the battleground states. And, you know, so we look at the numbers in those battleground states, and you'll see it's a lot smaller number. That smaller number, and you want the number to be smaller. Strategically, as an activist, you want to make that number much, much smaller. The margin of victory for Obama was the Republicans who didn't vote in the swing states. And the reason you want that small number is you want them to respect small numbers so they respect you. And they listen to you, and they'll change. Yes, sir?
Who do you like? Who do you think it's going to be?
There are four I like. I have problems with all four. There's five I like. Four I like equally, and the fifth is kind of on my next rung slightly down. I have problems with all five, and I am uncertain how I would go. The four that in my mind are equal, but for totally different reasons, are Rand Paul, Ted Cruz, Bobby Jindal, and Scott Walker. And the one who is just kind of sort of a rung down is Marco Rubio. And you'd think, well, why not Carly Fiorina? Why not Ben Carson? I have reasons, and we can talk about those privately, but I went ahead and told you where I'm at. And I, honest to God, don't know. There isn't a Pierce-driven snow guy out there. There isn't one. And that tells me we need to get the best we can, create the best relationship we can with the best we can, so that we can hold their feet to the fire, and then concentrate on Congress. A vice president's nomination's purpose is to make sure we win. And part of that purpose is to make sure that the nominee looks good. We, as a party, made a huge mistake in choosing Jack Kemp as Bob Dole's, and obviously Bob Dole chose him. Why? because Jack Kemp outshined him. Okay. Kind of made the same mistake with Paul Ryan. I mean, Paul Ryan kind of outshined Mitt Romney just a little bit. And it's a real mistake, so you don't want that. And believe me, Carly Fiorina would have a huge likelihood of outshining our nominee otherwise. You want the nominee to look the best. And so you want the vice presidential nominee to be somebody who won't go rogue, who will speak the line. I mean, I do. If our nominee is Rand Paul, if our nominee is Chris Christie, okay? I don't want Chris Christie, okay? But I don't want Hillary Clinton either. And so, you know, I want the vice presidential nominee to really prop up the Republican ticket. Now, there is a person, and I'm probably going to get shouted down, there is a person, I think, who would do a great job of propping up the Republican ticket, who will speak what she is told to speak, who will do what she's told to do, who hasn't lost an election, who's been in a lot of offices, who would do a very good job, who would present herself very, very well, who's been statewide elected and in Congress, and it's our governor. And I think she would be, strategically, regardless of who the nominee is, good at that job. Sorry. Yeah. I understand, but think about what she would do for the nominee. Yeah, but she, believe me, that doesn't mean that she would become the next nominee. Oh, we have made contact with the Glenn Beck, and believe me, every author of political fiction is trying very, very hard to get in with it. Oh, there's been a lot of people talking about that. It's been described by some people as political fiction meets House of Cards meets romance novel. So, you know, it's got a strong romantic thing in it, and it would make a great movie. That's a great way to reach millennials. That's why I went with that medium. Anybody else? Been a lot of questions. I really appreciate it. Thank you so much. I do have a bookmark if you buy the book, and it's available cash, check, or credit card.
That's right. Richard, thank you very much. I really appreciate you coming here and talking to us, and then talking to us afterwards. I think that was great. And let's appreciate Richard one more time.